Oh. Oh, Thanksgiving to the glory of God. Holy, Lord, we are. cardinal. For the first time, I think, in the history of our church, we have a big cardinal here at the same time on the same road. I'm so happy for that. Cardinal George is no stranger to our church. He is a benefactor, a supporter of our church, a person who has seen our church as being vital in the community of Christ, in the communion of the church. And for that reason, I have asked him to be here to rest on the earth, to give us his words of encouragement as a church in the 21st century. At the same time, after the cardinal has finished his homily, I will ask his beatitude, accept his love, and please honor us with his words and praying. With your indulgence, we still have the two language homily today. I'm sure both will be very encouraging. Open the words of Christ, the words of the gospel. At this moment, I ask your eminence to please come forward to give us your homily.
Bishops of the Catholic Church of this country, and I welcome always. therefore a truly joyful occasion for me and for all of you. And we thank God for these 50 years of the FRP as a particular church in Catholic Union. And we thank God particularly for the way in which in this part of the country, the Chicago area, the FRP has been so dynamic and has enabled, with the grace of God, to enrich society and the church in ways that are truly important, with nonetheless some challenges. Well, if we celebrate anniversaries, particularly an anniversary of 50 years, we are invited to look into the history of Ukraine, history of the Catholic Ukrainian Church in our country. And as someone who did not share that history in Ukraine, I recognized when I visited how it had been marked by dictatorship and by war, by the persecution of the Catholic Ukrainian Church, by its oppression, and yet also by sanctity. One of the most touching conversations I had during the short couple of weeks we spent in Ukraine 6 years ago was the wife of a priest who had been martyred under the Russian dictatorship and who had been beatified by Holy Father Pope John Paul II shortly before the opening of Ukraine. To listen to this faithful woman's tale of her support for her husband as he strived to under the cover of darkness, under the constant surveillance of the secret police, which continued to be grateful to God for the life that had been given her, the life that called her as well as her husband to sanctity, a life of total dedication in the midst of enormous sorrows, told me something about the names of the saint in our history of the last 50 years. Here, of course, the history is one of immigration, isn't it? All of us are immigrants, or children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren of immigrants. And when immigrants come to the United States, the temptation is always to freeze, especially their spiritual life, their ecclesiastical life, according to the pattern of what they do
in the country where they were first, where they were born, where they were first introduced
to Christ. And so, in every immigrant group, it's true for the Germans who fought the Irish to maintain their own churches until the First World War. It was true also of those from Eastern Europe, which are churches here, those who bless the Croatians, the Poles, the Lithuanians, the Ukrainians. If in fact your own contribution in the enveloping history of the last 50 years has been secure, has been as rich as it has been, largely because you have enjoyed protection of a stable eparchy, protection of this eparchy of St. Nicholas, of the Ukrainians, of Chicago, and have been able to reach out in novel ways, in new ways, in your own ways, to strengthen our society and to enrich Catholicism here, the parish all of here, your many works, your ministries, your friendships. They have made us all what we are. We are immensely grateful. The habits, however, of living in a time of persecution may unfortunately be of more benefit to you here than any of us could have imagined a couple of years ago. For life here, in this country which is supposed to be the homeland of freedom and hope, is beginning to look ever more difficult and oppressive, as much oppressive as anywhere else. The institutions of our economy and of our political life find us for so many decades are now collapsing around us, and more, for the first time in the history of this country, there is a legal persecution of the Catholic Church, subtle still, but ready to be far more overt, I believe, in the future. The National Relations, Labor Relations Board can tell the University like St. Xavier's and the South Side of Chicago whether it is Catholic or not. Regulating agencies of the federal government can tell ministries of Catholic Church, ministries of the Catholic Church, whether they are Catholic or not. The government takes it upon itself to tell us what the nature of marriage is, the natural institution given by the Creator before the existence of any state, before
now officially a discriminatory organization under Illinois law. The consequences of all this have not yet been worked out. Still, the structure is there. We know from history the last 2 years that the secularization of a culture leads inevitably to the secularization of the state. The state is supreme, and it claims to be supreme, and God disappears from public life. I never thought, growing up in Chicago, that I would have to say this in this church or any other church at any time in my life. And yet, it is something that is with us, something that your own history will perhaps in particular ways help us to understand how to become saints in ways that are going to be far more difficult than anything you experienced in the last 50 years or any of us else did as well. And yet, why should we be too surprised? Last night, our Holy Father, Pope Benedict XVI, spoke to the young people of modern Germany, people who had never known Nazi oppression, people who are well-educated and well-fed, and who never anything but security in their religious life and in their secular life. He spoke to them about evil, drawing on the contrast between light and darkness that St. Paul spoke about in the second letter to the Corinthians that we just proclaimed. The Pope, speaking to the young people of his own moment, said, truly, we see in so many places evil in a way that frightens us. We see it in our own lives, for within our hearts there is a tendency towards evil. There is selfishness, envy, and aggression. And we know that as well, for if there is external evil, it is echoed by the internal voice of individualism, of disunity, compares to a thick fog, such as cold or laziness in willing and doing good. That the greatest danger to the church, the Pope said, comes not from her opponents, but from unbelieving Christians. Then he makes appeal to the experience I had in speaking to that priest's wife in the Ukraine in 2004. Why should we be surprised? For it is indeed the grace of God that brings conversion from our own sinfulness and social sins set us in every age and every time until Christ returns to be glory. But in that, there is sanctity. The Pope said there is no sanctity apart from the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, who has not also known sin, who has never fallen. Christ is not so much interested in how often in our lives we stumble and fall, as in how often with his help we pick ourselves up again. He does not command glittering achievements, but he wants light to shine in you. You are the light of Christ in the world. So hold the young people. You are holy. We are holy. We allow Christ's grace to work in us, to shine from us. So in the scripture reading that we have just heard proclaimed, we know what St. Paul says, that we are to be the light of the world, even though afflicted in every way, we are not constrained, perplexed, and not driven to despair. Persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed, always caring about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus, through suffering and all manners of trials, the one single abiding, absolute certainty is that we are going forward toward life in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. Therefore, even in suffering, our lives are fruitful. We saw heard in the Gospel just proclaimed the beginning of this spiritual journey of walking in the footsteps of Jesus Christ so that we can be his light to the world. We saw the beginning of this journey in St. Peter, who recognizing in the presence of the Lord how sinful he was, nonetheless called out that sinfulness into discipleship and then into sanctity. With St. Peter we can hear the commands that Jesus gave him and gives all those who follow way of the Lord Jesus on the path of sanctity in this life. But Christ gives us 3 commands in the Gospel just so beautifully proclaimed in Ukrainian and in English. First, he tells us, put out into the water. Do not allow the superficiality to invade your life. A routinization, as Pope John Paul II used to say, that covers over the dignity of the universal. Dignity that is ours as creatures of God and as baptized disciples, sons
understand the challenges of life in the deepest water. Do not escape into any kind of fantasy, in any kind of imagined past, in any kind of entertainment that dissipates. Meet the challenges of life. Swim. Go into the deep water, the challenges that are there. In 50 years, you have certainly done that. And in these 50 years, others have tried as well. We are together in that. Secondly, the Lord commands Peter and the disciples and ourselves as well, lower your nets or catch. It's not just a question of defending ourselves, trying to swim in water that is deeper than our own height. It's a question rather of fishing in that water, of trusting in God enough to go forward. Do what you have done in your eparchy for years. Be perishable. I mean, teach people the next generation who Christ is. To do it with the roots of the Ukrainian Catholic culture in such a way that that is not an obstacle to unity with others, but rather a gift of share, for which the rest of us can deeply appreciate and accept it and want to continue to accept it. In its own distinctiveness, always, but in a way that enriches us all. We hope that you find that kind of continued dialogue and cultural sharing of riches, which is possible because of the unity of the faith. We hope that will be strengthened in the 50 years which come. Lord, your nets for a catch. The third and last command that the Lord gives St. Peter and all of us is, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid in the light of the collapse of the economic and political structures I mentioned. Do not be afraid because of the dangers to Catholicism in this country, unfortunately. Do not be afraid of our own sinfulness, the traps and prisons of our own making. Do not be afraid. There is a way to stem our fear, not only through frequent prayer and the participation in the liturgy of the church, but also to stay connected, to stay together. But it is not possible for anyone to look at any one of us and imagine that he or she is not part of the family of God. He or she does not have the protection of those who love them. He or she is not isolated. This togetherness, in good times and in bad, in our history and in the present situation as well, is absolutely necessary not only because of external enemies, but because of internal proclivities towards sin. We know that. With St. Peter we ask for forgiveness, but also with St. Peter now, to take up the task, to ask for discipleship, of not being fearful as we lower the nets, as we go forward in such a way that the light of Christ may shine more clearly, more strongly, throughout our 18th anniversary to celebrate the Holy Catholic Church.
Наших мирян. збудована завдяки отим величезним зусиллям наших християнських організацій, наших доброчинців, які своєю працею і молитвою прилучалися і прилучаються до будівництва нашої спільноти громадської і церковної в Чикаго і в цій парку. Як не згадати десятки тисяч наших людей, які зранку і ввечері молилися за свою церкву і за свій український народ, яку, можливо, останню лепту давали підтримки своїй українській церкві. Тому сьогодні, в день святкування золотого ювілею цієї партії, за всіх них лунає до Господа наша молитва. Я хочу сьогодні всіх вас привітати, які прибули до того храму, можливо, здалека, щоб разом помолитися зі мною. Я знаю, що приїхало 8 автобусів з Детройту і з інших міст єпархії. 45 парафій є присутніх, 30 представників 30 різних парафій цієї єпархії. Я сьогодні вами всіма тішуся і пишаюся. Цей ювілей, слід за словами його Евіденції Карла Джорджа, хочу вас уклінно просити бути добрими християнами. Це святкування побачило величезний дар Божий, який він хоче дати кожному з вас. Не загубіть віру своїх батьків, своїй культурі, своїй мови, бо це завжди було багатством усіх наших попередників. Сьогодні особливо хочу звернутися до нашої молоді. Мені дуже приємно бачити в храмі так багато молодих людей, молодих батьків, матерів і дітей. Бо сьогодні починається певний період історії нашої церкви, коли Господь кличе брати відповідальність за свою церкву саме вас, молодих. Відкрити цінність і вартість того вічного життя, яке випливає з того джерела, яке тут, в цьому місці, відкрив для вас Господь Бог. Нехай святий Миколай, який покровитель цієї партії, буде для вас молитвенником, зірцем і підтримкою. Нехай пречиста Діва Марія, яка завжди була нашим небесним покровом, вас покриває і провадить. А я, як новопокликаний отець і глава вашої церкви, хочу вам сьогодні сказати, що ваша мати церква про всіх вас пам'ятає. Ніхто з вас не є забутий чи забутий. Про всіх вас кожного дня в усіх наших храмах заноситься молитва до нашого Господа Бога. Я хочу сьогодні підтвердити, потвердити ту внутрішню єдність, яка поєднує нашу церкву, яка розкидана по різних континентах, але з'єднана як один єдиний живий організм, як тіло Христове. Нехай це святкування оживить усіх нас, поможе направо нам усім ще раз відкрити той скарб, який носимо у своєму серці. Я щиро вітаю усіх вас, молюся за вас і благословляю. Слава Ісусу Христу!
Thank you. Oh. Oh.
the benefits bestowed upon us, both manifested and hidden. We thank you also for the liturgy which you have guided to accept from our hands, even through the hands that stand before you thousands of archangels and 10,000 of angels, the cherubim and seraphim, sing wings and many eyes, powering a lot of their wings.
Thank you.
Дорогие цветы церквам, чтобы мы и цели. Нас на суши, Господь.
tako i jak suda, ali jak pozdini spovjedaje se tobi. Pomjani mene, Gospode, kole pretješ u carstvi tvoji. Pomjani mene, Vladiko, kole pretješ u carstvi tvoji. Pomjani mene, Svjati, kole pretješ u carstvi tvoji. Ne daj mi na sudi nego suđenja, bude mi i prišćasti Svjati tvoji kraj, Gospode, a ne silinja duši. Bože, milo s Tebe i Božki mi zvišću. Bože, očiste mojih primitivi pomiluj me. Veće slava i šeća, Gospode, prospiri.
I believe, O Lord, and confess, that You are truly Christ, the Son of the living God, who came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the first. Accept me this day, O Son of God, as a partaker of Your mystical supper. I will not tell the mystery to your enemies, nor will I give you a kiss as did Judas, but like the thief I confess to you. Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. Remember me, O Master, when you come into your kingdom. Remember me, O Holy One, when you come into your kingdom. May the partaking of your holy mysteries, O Lord, be unto me not for judgment or condemnation, but for the healing of soul and body. God be merciful to me, a sinner. God cleanse me of my sins and have mercy on me. I have sinned without number. Forgive me, O Lord.
Thank you. just brought my next one.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh.
Нашим чекарським архієпископом Миколаєм, поздрави і спасені, посвящені.